This is the Whole Hog Sports Football Podcast, presented by Massage Envy, featuring interviews, analysis, and feature stories on Arkansas football. Now, from Fayetteville, here's your host, Seth Campbell.
For the first time in 15 games, the left lane opened up, and the Razorbacks put the hammer down.
First pass of the game is caught. Traylon Burks out of bounds. He'll fake it to Boyd, going up top, coming near side, trying to hit Trey Knox. Touchdown, Arkansas. That was quick.
After three games, the team, like C.G. O'Grady, had to grow up quick.
The old me probably would have said, it's whatever. I don't care, really. I'm sick, so wah, baby. Like I'm a baby or something like that. Yeah, I just had to overcome it, and I decided to play, and some good things happened all around.
What CJ defines as good may have been great, as this play was the second best play of the day, according to ESPN SportsCenter.
He's still on his feet. Down to the 30! Are you kidding me? He's going to take it to the end zone!
Starkle, the new king of the North, well, Northwest Arkansas anyway, will have to ready himself once again as the Hogs will take on their second Mountain West foe in as many weeks. From Whole Hog Sports, I'm Seth Campbell, and this is the Whole Hog Football Podcast. On today's show, we'll talk about the unknown ties between the San Jose State Spartans and the Arkansas Razorbacks. We'll also talk to Justin Allegri, the play-by-play broadcaster for the Spartans. Then, we'll wrap it up with the most experienced Razorback roundtable out there, as Tom Murphy, Bob Holt, and Scotty Bordelon discuss the Hogs game against San Jose State. But first, a word from our sponsor, Massage Envy. Massage Envy, voted the top day spa in all of Northwest Arkansas, now is even better with the addition of Jammarini and Obagi skincare services and products. These exciting new lines are provided, as well as a serum-infused microdermabrasion and chemical peels. Our face is one of the most important features that we have. Proper skincare services and products will enhance and protect your face, while the benefits, well, they could extend a lifetime. No matter your gender, come by either clinic in Rogers or Fayetteville today for your introductory session. When you dive into the record book between the Arkansas Razorbacks and the San Jose State Spartans, no floaties are needed. The schools, well, they've never played on the gridiron before. In fact, if you wanted to drive to San Jose State's campus from Fayetteville, it would take you over a day. But just because over 1,800 miles separate the two campuses, that doesn't mean there aren't some common ties between the two schools. Let's start with the head coaches. San Jose State head coach Brent Brennan says he kept up with Chad Morris, especially while he was at SMU.
I was watching what they did at SMU closely. My mother and father-in-law are SMU alums, so that was, and my wife grew up going to those games there with the Pony Express and all that good stuff. So that's a program that we've always kept an eye on. So we watched Chad's progress over time there.
Beyond the head coaches, the starting quarterbacks for both of the teams might know each other as well. San Jose State's Josh Love and Arkansas's Nick Starkle both attended the same summer 2019 quarterback camp, the Steve Clarkson Dreammakers quarterback camp. Arkansas has had a few guys coach for both the Spartans and the Razorbacks. Among those that have worn both colors is current tight ends coach Barry Lunny Jr. Barry Lunny Jr. was the Spartans quarterbacks coach in 2003 and 2004 and was co-offensive coordinator in 2004. Among others with Arkansas and San Jose State ties is former Razorback assistant coach Fitz Hill. Hill was San Jose State's head coach from 2001 through 2004. Former defensive coordinator Willie Robinson was a San Jose State graduate assistant in 1979. He coached linebackers at that time. San Jose State and Arkansas also share some history. The Spartans and Razorbacks are two of six colleges claiming two alums as Super Bowl winning head coaches. Most Arkansas fans are familiar with their two Super Bowl winners. Jimmy Johnson won two Super Bowl titles for the Cowboys before handing over the reins to another former Razorback, Barry Switzer. But what about the Spartans? Their first Super Bowl winning head coach was Bill Walsh, who coached the San Francisco 49ers from 1979 to 1988. Walsh won 3 Super Bowls during his time with the 49ers. The other head coach? Well, if memories of the St. Louis Rams still give you heartache, then you may want to close your ears for this one. Dick Vermeil, who led the Rams to a Super Bowl victory in 2000, is the other Spartan grad, who has also won a Super Bowl. Before we move on and we hear from Spartans play-by-play announcer Justin Allegri, I thought I'd leave you with a trivial fact to impress your friends. The San Jose State Spartans are going to be the only team in FBS football to play in 5 time zones this year. The Spartans travel to Army West Point to play a team in the Eastern time zone. The Hogs and the University of Tulsa take care of the Central time zone. San Jose State plays multiple teams in the Mountain time zone, which, well, makes sense since they are in the Mountain West Conference. San Jose is located in the Pacific time zone. In the 5th time zone? Well, you guessed it. The Spartans will travel to Hawaii on November 9th to take on the Rainbow Warriors.
Massage Envy with clinics in Rogers and Fayetteville has been awarded Northwest Arkansas's Best Day Spa and Best Massage. One of the reasons is our care for athletes, both serious and recreational. We now offer rapid tension relief sessions using a high-caliber vibrating tool and total body stretch sessions like the ones used by the PGA. Both of these new services can be combined with the always popular deep muscle treatment. So whether you compete or just want to relax, there is no place better than Massage Envy.
WholeHogSports.com has the largest, most experienced staff of reporters covering sports in Arkansas. Football, basketball, baseball, recruiting, and more. You'll find it at WholeHogSports.com. The website includes up-to-minute news, daily commentaries, and award-winning photography from the staffs of Hogs Illustrated and the Democrat Gazette. For subscriptions, call 1-800-757-6277. That's 1-800-757-6277. Or visit us online today. WholeHogSports.com.
The old Hogs, we didn't know how to respond. We all just got down, the energy lowered. This year is just completely different.
CJ O'Grady there on the Hogs' response after Colorado State tied last week's game at 34 points. Welcome back to the Whole Hog Football Podcast. Seth Campbell joined alongside now Justin Allegri, the play-by-play voice for the San Jose State Spartans. You can hear him in the San Francisco, San Jose State area on 910 Real Talk AM. Justin, thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Seth.
All right, so one of the main things that sticks out about San Jose is their two quarterback system with Josh Love and Nick Nash. What do they bring to the table?
Well, it's kind of interesting. If you were to ask me coming out of fall camp, hey, who's your number two guy? I would have selected Chance LaChapelle, who had some experience from last year. And then we go into that first game against Northern Colorado, and like you said, it was Nick Nash coming off the bench for the second reps of the game, and he was more brought in a short downage type of situation where they wanted to see his ability to run the ball. But in that first game, he ran a whole drive, went down the field, and ultimately, being a true freshman, ran into some problems near the goal line and fumbled it. So you kind of expect some growing pains with a true freshman quarterback out there for his first snaps as a college player. But then in the second game, they brought him into some short downage situations, and when Josh Love took a hit late in the game, they let him drive down the field again, and he was able to go get a touchdown for the Spartans. But I think the big difference between the two of them, Josh Love, a 3-year starter for San Jose State, has gone through a lot in his career, but he's really more refined now. He's able to hit the open receivers. He's looking more mature out there. He's making the right decisions, which has led to kind of a more methodical type of offense with him out there. And when the Spartans want to change things up, they're looking for something to throw a monkey wrench into the game. And I think they're trying to establish that with Nash and his ability to run the ball. And I think that's something that pops out when you first watch him. I don't think the arm is quite there yet in his freshman year. I think he has the ability, but it's something he has to learn. So he's relying more on his legs. And that's really the stark contrast between the two of them. And look, I mean, the Spartans know that Josh Love, this is his last year. They have to find a starter for next season. And why not try and give some of these younger backups some snaps here this year and let them get their feet wet throughout the season and see what works and see what needs to be worked on going into the offseason.
You know, Brent Brennan, the head coach at San Jose State, you know, he's 4-23 overall record. This is his third year. You know, Arkansas is kind of going through a similar situation. Chad Morris, only 4 wins through 2 years as well. I believe his record is 4-11. What do you and San Jose State fans really expect from Brennan in his year 3?
Well, it's a big year for the coaching staff, just because the first 2 years at this level and at the way he took over the program and the spot he took over the program, you kind of expected there would be this lull where he needs to go out and recruit. He needs to establish his players on the field, the type of play he wants to see on the field. And then there are also things that he wanted to do off the field and help facilities get up to par with the Mountain West Conference and make sure the APR scores and all those numbers are going up. So the first 2 years, he really focused a lot on everything, not just on the field of play. But now in year 3, you expect all the recruits to be his and his coaching staff's guys. And this is a big year for him to show progress on the field now that he's established his players as recruits. So, yeah, I think there is a little bit of pressure on him and the coaching staff. But there's also a lot of bright spots to see in the young players that he's brought on. I think it's a different spot just because you if you're at Arkansas, you know, you're an established program and you're obviously playing in the best conference in the country for football. You want to be competitive right away. But for San Jose State, I think they recognize that other factors were involved before they could bring up the win totals and really compete in the Mountain West Conference. So, but this is the year for him. I think he has to show some progress. I think the expectations are that he is competitive in conference play once that starts to come along, and that he shows something moving forward going into next year, which ultimately would be his fourth and something that you'd have higher expectations for.
You mentioned something there towards the beginning when you're talking about Brennan needing to bring in his own players. You know, that's been a common theme here in the University of Arkansas as well. You know, Chad Morris needs to bring in his players, especially going from Brett Bielema, the previous coach, who ran a completely different offensive system. From your experience, how important is it for a coach to have his quote-unquote players?
Well, I think it's critical. Unless you're going to be running a similar style offense and defense than the previous coaching staff, I think you can kind of get along with it that way. But at the same time, even if that's the case, you're working with players that you didn't recruit, that weren't brought in with the knowledge of the coaching staff that you're putting together. So I think it's a challenge. I mean, put yourself in the shoes of a player. You know, you were recruited by the previous head coach and his staff. You like the guys. You understand the system. You have a relationship with them. And then it all gets turned upside down, and you have to learn a new offense or defense. You have to learn a new coaching staff. You have to prove yourself again to that coaching staff, perhaps, if you need to. So it's a challenge. But I think, and again, this can kind of go to different levels. For a team like San Jose State that's trying to establish themselves, I think you'd almost need to bring in your own guys just so that you can show that there is a change and a growth, because it wasn't working 2 or 3 years ago. You have to show that change. And you look at what Arkansas has been able to do. I mean, I was just looking at the wide receiving core that Coach Morris has brought in. I mean, it's tremendous, but they still haven't seen the true benefits of it yet, which can be frustrating. I think that's that all factors in. But as a coaching staff goes, I think it just makes it so much more easier and more comfortable if you have your own guys that you understand, that they understand you, and they're able to do what you want with the system you're running.
As we mentioned earlier, Brennan, 4-23 overall record at San Jose State. What does San Jose State need to do to be competitive in the Mountain West this year?
Absolutely, 100%, they have to run the football with more effectiveness. It's been something that the Spartans have not been able to do the last couple of seasons. There have been some injuries here and there as a kind of a factor in that, but the Spartans know that they just have to run the football much, much more better than they have in the last 2 years. And the first couple of games, while you look at the numbers and say it's a little bit better, the Spartans only ran for 16 yards against Tulsa in the first half. So they know that that's going to be a major factor this year. And any team knows that you have to have a balance in the run and the pass game. And the Spartans just haven't been able to have that. So teams have been sitting back in coverage and just saying, try and throw at us, and see what happens, because they haven't been able to run the ball with effectiveness. So that's the number one thing for me, is the Spartans have to find a way, however they can, with however many running backs that they can, to run the football with some authority, just to alleviate the pressure on the passing game for the Spartan receivers and the quarterbacks. That's the biggest thing this year, and Coach Brennan knows it. That was his goal coming into this season. He felt like the goals set for last season were good in the turnover margin, which they improved drastically. But this year, it's the run game. It's the run game. It's the run game.
That's understandable. They ranked last in all of FBS last year in the run game, so definitely want to focus on that. But on the defensive side, the Spartans lost one of their leaders to graduation, Bryson Bridges. Who has stepped up for the defense?
Well, and you look at the defensive line, it was Bryson Bridges and Boogie Roberts that both graduated for San Jose State, two of the three starters on the defensive line, and two guys that played a majority of the games last year for San Jose State. Now, you couple that with Silosi Latu, who was injured a good amount last year, and just recently, I say recently, about a week before the season started, was granted to play another season. NCAA granted the waiver, so he's back, which helps. But what we've seen now in the first couple of games is a rotation of about nine different players on the defensive line unit. And that's not because they don't know who they want to play. That's because they finally have some depth and they want to keep guys fresh out there so they can help rush the quarterback. So it's been fun to watch. It's been interesting to watch. I don't know that we have a standout type player just yet on the defensive line. Cade Hall's been playing well. Silosi's been playing well on the defensive line. But to me, those nine guys are important because they at least help the rest of the defense. Where you look at the strength of the Spartan defense, it's the linebacking unit. And those guys, I mean, last year were forced to make a lot of tackles for San Jose State. I mean, Ethan Aguayo, over 100 tackles. Jesse Osuna right behind him. And those two guys are back again. Ethan's leading the nation in tackles per game already. He made 20 in the first game. He's averaging 17 in the first two for San Jose State. But you look at this, the workload and the amount of hits he takes, and that's not sustainable. So they need to try and counterbalance that. But those two up the middle for the linebacking core have been a lot of fun to watch, and very different players. Jesse Osuna, we joke, sometimes runs with his hair on fire, it seems like. He's all over the place and a violent player, and he hits with a lot of physicality. And then Ethan's more of a technical player, and he really gets to the right spot in the right time. So that would be the strength, and the difference this year has been the rotations they've had up front early on.
Talking to Justin Allegri, play-by-play voice for the San Jose State Spartans here on the Whole Hog Football Podcast. All right, Justin, last question before we let you go. You know, through your research and scouting of the Arkansas Razorbacks, what has been your impression of them?
It's tough. It's interesting because you look at the opponents, and we San Jose State always looks at common opponents or opponents they can kind of relate to see how you can go about working against a team like this. This is the first time they've ever met, so there's a lot of unfamiliarity there. But we look at the way that Colorado State approached the game against Arkansas, because the Spartans know Colorado State. And I think what you're seeing is a very youthful team that is still not very confident in the way they go about certain elements of their game. And maybe that fourth quarter against Colorado State helped that confidence. But to me, that's something that I think teams may try to expose this year, especially early in games. So you have some untested, unproven position players for Arkansas. A lot of young guys getting their first snaps in college ball. And I think that is a big part of it, especially when Arkansas plays in the SEC and you're going to be going up against fourth-year, fifth-year guys a lot of the time that have lived out their career and they already know what they're doing to the best of their ability. So that's going to be a big challenge. And it goes back to the recruits brought in just because those guys need to get experience. And so to me, early on in the game is the spot where you're going to have to try and assert a level of offense against Arkansas to try and counteract what they're going to bring late in the game when they kind of figure you out. So especially in the first time against an opponent, that's going to be critical.
All right, he's Justin Allegri, as I said, play-by-play voice for the San Jose State Spartans. You can catch him in the Bay Area in California on 910 Real Talk AM. Justin, thanks so much for your time.
Thanks, Seth. I appreciate it.
Massage Envy has been voted the best day spa and best massage in all of Northwest Arkansas. One reason is our great therapists and estheticians. Due to increased demand with our new services in both massage and skincare, Massage Envy is now looking for talented, licensed providers to join our great team. A competitive compensation package and family-like environment are just some of the reasons our providers have worked nearly 10 years with Massage Envy. Looking for a great career? Come by our clinics in Rogers or Fayetteville and apply today. Want more coverage of your home team? Download the Whole Hog Sports Video On Demand app. Check out the Fan Zone and get up-to-the-minute videos, podcasts, and features on football, basketball, baseball, recruiting, and more. Search for Whole Hog Sports on Apple TV, Roku, and Amazon Fire at home. And take it with you on the go by downloading it for your mobile device in your app store. The Whole Hog Sports Video On Demand app. Get it today.
Coach Mo, Coach Momentum, he's on our side. So we need to be able to keep him on our side. Momentum's big in this game, especially in the SEC, no matter who you're playing. Wins are big, and if we can string a couple along going into A&M, but we gotta focus on this week and this week only and try to get more momentum for us.
That's linebacker Grant Morgan on the Hogs needing to keep the wins rolling against San Jose State.
Welcome into the Whole Hog Football Podcast. We have got a great roundtable for you today. Bob Holt, Scotty Bordelon, and Tom Murphy are joining us. And guys, Arkansas won 55-34 against Colorado State. We're going to start over here on my left and go with Scotty. What did you know? Starkel made his first start of his Razorback career. What did you see from Starkel?
Yeah, I think at the beginning of the game, he showed great command for the offense. And part of that was probably, I don't want to take anything away from Nick because Nick made the throws, but I think he looked really good with the plays that Chad Morris and Joe Craddock scripted for the first few series. Arkansas, I think, got touchdowns on their first three drives and field goals on their next two. So he looked pretty good early, and then he looked pretty good late. I can't remember what he threw for in the fourth quarter, but he didn't miss many passes and threw some pretty clutch passes to Trey Knox, Traylon Burks, and then he hit C.J. O'Grady on that long touchdown pass. That was just an unbelievable effort from O'Grady. That was pretty unbelievable. But he, other than like, I guess there was a little bit of a lull from him, maybe in the middle part of the game, where I think he completed like 3 of 10 passes for like 23 yards and had a few balls tipped at the line and had a throwaway down inside the red zone. But other than, you know, kind of the maybe a stretch in the middle of the game, he was pretty sharp. You know, I charted him with 6 inaccurate passes, but out of 35, that's not too bad.
No, not at all. I just like the way the threat. And I think I said it here last week, the threat of him throwing downfield is what I like. He overthrew a couple guys that maybe as time goes by, the timing of those will be a little bit better and they can hit some really big plays. You know, I'm talking about like a 70-yard touchdown mm-hmm. pass. And I liked it that in the fourth quarter, the first possession, 3 passes in a row, they went bam, 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 Knox, Burks, Knox, and they were in field goal range. Just like that, ended up getting a touchdown. Also, and this is kind of the under-the-radar thing that I really liked about him, when there was a lot of adversity going on the 4th-and-1, weren't sure if the spot was right on Boyd or not, so there was this lull, and people wanted them to go for it, which on your own 35 is risky. And they called timeout. The offense was going to the sideline, and fans were booing on that section. And you could hear it. He put his hands in the air and did the old wave down, like, hey, calm down, people. You know, chill out. This is gonna be okay. And I just think that shows a certain part of his personality that he's, you know, he's in command and he's comfortable in his own skin, as those Dove commercials would say. And I like that about him, Bob.
Yeah, he's definitely got the swagger and confidence I think you want in a quarterback. I think he displayed that when you interviewed him over the summer for the award-winning Hog Future Series. But, yeah, he as you said, he missed on a couple deep balls, but overall threw the ball pretty well. He clearly, I think, has developed some chemistry with those freshman receivers. They have confidence in him. I thought Scooter Harris, he's a defensive guy, but I thought he made a good point that, with Starkel in there, the receivers all know they need to be ready because the ball might be coming to them. I just think, when you feel like you've got, a big-time quarterback and he's a guy that started in the SEC previously, then it just kind of keeps everybody on their toes more and brings out a little, everybody plays just a little bit better.
So Arkansas, they racked up the most yards in a Chad Morris offense since he's been in Arkansas. I got a simple question that doesn't have a simple answer, guys. Why? We'll start with Utah.
Well, the pace was not super fast. They got going a few times, and I like that. They varied the pace. I didn't know if they'd be able to go that fast with Starkel in his first starting appearance. But because of the deep threat, they had nice running lanes. And by the way, the O-linemen earned all kind of awards this week. You saw Pro Football Focus honor Ty Clary with his national team. On the touchdown runs, he was sealing guys off, and they were big holes. I don't think anybody touched Rakeem Boyd on either of his touchdowns, nor on Whaley's touchdown, which was over the left side. So they just had balance, and they used some tempo, and thus they got 520 yards.
Yeah, I think part of it was Starkel being your quarterback. He was the fifth guy to start a quarterback in the last 15 games, and I don't think it's even close. He's head and shoulders above all the other guys who have started. So I think you start there. And like Tom said, the offensive line had a really good game. I think Boyd's a lot better than he was last year because, he's not hurt. He's healthy and he's fresh and he has been with them for a whole year. And some of it had to do with Colorado State too, because I think they gave 52 points to.
Yeah, not a great defense.
Yeah, to Colorado. So I think it was a combination of all those things.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Yeah, I agree. Starkel was pretty good. On throws 11 plus yards downfield, he was 6 out of 12, 188 yards, 2 touchdowns. So you saw Arkansas stretch the field vertically and just hit Colorado State over the top a little bit. And I know Nick wants some of those balls back because a couple of his misses would have gone for touchdowns, no doubt. But good play from the offensive line too. Like I watched, I think on Rakeem Boyd's second touchdown run, his 4-yarder, Ricky Stromberg at right guard gets to the second level so quick and gets to the linebacker and just peels open this gaping hole for Rakeem to run through. And it was the same thing, Stromberg and Ty Clary on Rakeem's first touchdown run too. Those guys were sharp. And it feels like you finally got some pretty solid playmakers on the outside. Obviously you got O'Grady back too, so plenty of weapons and plenty of yards.
Boyd is another weapon that the University of Arkansas has under Morris. He rushed for 122 yards against Colorado State. I got another not so easy question. We'll start with you, Bob. Boyd is the best Arkansas running back since who?
Maybe not since McFadden.
Collins.
I was thinking either him or Raleigh Williams.
Yeah, Raleigh. Raleigh obviously was a great back whose career unfortunately was cut short by the neck injury. Yeah, I'd say since Raleigh Williams.
Okay, what do you think, Scotty?
Yeah, I kind of came – I thought of Raleigh Williams was the first one that popped into my head. Alex Collins was good too. Rakeem just – and all those guys have such special traits that are just particular to their own game. Like Alex Collins had great feet. Rakeem Boyd, I think, is running with a lot more power, and he's got great speed to go with it. Raleigh Williams had a little bit of both. Like, he could run by it. He could run over you, too. Rakeem's just – he's special. Like, I remember talking on the first podcast what Jason Brown told me. He's as good as any of the 27 guys he'd put in the pros. I said that, I think, last spring. Rakeem's special, man. Yeah, I'd probably say he's the best since Raleigh.
Yeah, he's a great talent. I mean, you could argue about who he's the best since. He's not better than McFadden, so somebody since then. I really liked Alex Collins. I thought his vision, as Scotty pointed out, just his jump cuts, he was really good. I think he's faster than Raleigh Williams, maybe by a hair, Rakeem Boyd is. His explosion up the guy, I mean, the safety had the angle on him on the 59-yarder and didn't touch him.
Yeah,
that's how fast he was. You surprised that guy with his speed. And, he gets a lot out of the runs. There was one in particular, he was kind of hitting the backfield and he spun around and dove forward and got about 3 or 4 yards out of what could have been a 1-yarder. So a lot of intangibles there too.
going over to the other side, you know, Chavis put an emphasis on turnovers this year. And really, so far, it's worked out. They had 3 in the first game, 2 in the second, 2 in the third. From what you've seen so far, Scotty, will the Arkansas defense have to force turnovers to keep games close against SEC competition?
I think so, looking at the run defense so far. Like, through 3 games, they're last in the SEC, giving up like 177 yards on the ground a game. The pass defense, I think, has been okay. I know Monteric Brown got beat across the middle by, I think, Warren Jackson for a score in the first half the other day. But that seems – those kind of plays seem – I don't want to say that they're kind of rare because they kind of got torched in week 2 by the kid from Ole Miss. But the pass defense, I think, has been okay. Run defense has been shaky. They're going to be without could be without Bumper Pool this week. They are getting Jamario Bell back. Hayden Henry's kind of a question mark too. Zach Williams is out. Like, that injury list is kind of – it's long, much longer than you'd like. Chavis said he thought that Arkansas met their takeaway standard the other day. They got 3, but one of them was wiped away because of Joe Fouché's roughing the passer penalty. But the 2 turnovers that they did get were pretty big, and I think they both led to points, so that was pretty big.
The simple answer for me is yes, they are going to have to force turnovers because they're giving up a lot of yardage. And so if you give up 40, 50 yards in a drive and you end up with a takeaway, then – you know, net gain. So I think they turned the first turnover into a field goal, and obviously the second one was a scoop and score touchdown. And it's good to see. I mean, they're yanking the ball out, and you know, they had the picks in the first game, none since then. And we hope that the pass rush holds up, because if it doesn't, then it cuts down on it, diminishes your chance to get turnovers. And I think with the ends in the situation they're in, it remains to be seen whether or not they're going to continually get pressure on quarterbacks in SEC play.
What do you think, Bob?
Yeah, I mean, the way they gave yards to Colorado State and Ole Miss, which I think Ole Miss got like 173 the week before, and then they got close to 500 on Arkansas. So you can just imagine what teams like, you know, A&M and LSU and Alabama are going to do to them. So to negate that, they've got to get some turnovers. And they've already scored 2 touchdowns on defense. You know, Curl had that and really long return against Ole Miss, and you know, Bishop had the scoop and score. So, yeah, if they can get some more scores on touchdowns, that'll help negate all those yards. But it's hard to picture them not giving up a whole lot of yards based on how the first few games have gone.
They've got to cut down on those busted plays that go for scores. Like, that's 2 times in 3 weeks, something like that's happened, and it almost like it looks elementary when it happens. Is it's just guys out of position, maybe shying away from contact, playing the ball instead of – or playing the receiver instead of the ball. It's just not a good look. They got to cut that down too.
Yeah, it was Bishop this week that kind of overplayed on the corner, was it not? And
I think it was Miles Mason. Miles Mason this week. Monteric got beat on the little post touchdown.
Nice. And everyone asked John Terrace about, you know, playing those young DBs. Well, when you see things like that happen, you can understand why he's hesitant to do it. But you know, they do have to play those guys. So.
I was looking on the field on that snap or on that series, I know, and there were 7 reserves. I think everybody on the front was a backup. I think Scooter Harris and maybe Hayden Henry were in there, but I think the 4 on the back or 3 guys in the back were all reserves. And so it's a broken play. Maybe they should have got the quarterback in the backfield. They didn't. He squeezed out and Miles Mason being off of his feet at the end of the jump ball is what cost him.
Talking about kind of depth, Bumper Pool, you know, he is listed as a starter on the depth chart this week, despite being seen in a sling after the Colorado State game. How important is Pool in that depth that he adds at the linebacker position for the Razorbacks, Tom?
I mean, he's big. He was leading the team in tackles before this game. But I think they can get through San Jose State. If it was me and he was questionable, I would probably hold him out. And maybe the same thing with Hayden Henry if his shoulder's not ready to go. And I think you can get through San Jose State in fine shape and give other guys. I mean, give Deion Edwards some snaps. And Devon McClure has made some nice side-to-side tackles already this season. So he gets more playing time. And then hopefully those other guys are ready when you get back in SEC play against A&M.
What do you think about
that? Yeah, I agree with Tommy. Not that they can take anybody lightly. And I think they're a 21-point favorite over San Jose, and they were a 28-point favorite over Portland State. We saw what happened there. But, yeah, I mean, I think if Bumper Pool's not fully healthy, you don't play him. this week, and you try to get some other guys in there because that's going to help your depth for down the line. And also, I mean, you're going to need Bumper Pool in those SEC games a lot more than you're going to need them against San Jose State. Or if they need Bumper Pool, then that's just not a good sign.
Yeah, man, if Bumper's questionable, maybe in a couple of days or maybe by Wednesday or Thursday, why not sit him, rest him, maybe Hayden Henry too. Get those guys ready for the biggest game of your season, like a game that could maybe determine like the trajectory of your season. And get guys like Tom said, Deion Edwards, Devon McClure was very aggressive the other day a few times, made some pretty big hits. And I really like him because with a guy like Bumper Pool out, I think the coaching staff likes Devon's maturity a little bit. And he does, like I said, he plays with a lot of aggression. And then maybe it's an opportunity for Andrew Parker to get onto the field more. We haven't really seen him just a whole lot aside from just a few, I don't want to call them meaningless snaps, but I don't think there was just a whole lot of, not a whole lot was on the line during those plays. But Andrew's a guy that I really like, and I don't know what's gone on with him. Maybe it's just guys surpassing him, learning the scheme, but it might be an opportunity for him to get in there too.
Kind of as we just said, San Jose State is a good opportunity for some guys to get some reps. And so I'm going to pose this question to you, Bob. What do you want to see the Hogs improve on from the Colorado State game to the San Jose State game?
Well, definitely defensively, don't give up 400 whatever yards. Mm-hmm. You don't give up 275-yard touchdowns. As you like to see the defense take a big leap against San Jose, because – you know, San Jose scored 16 points against Tulsa, and I don't know a ton about Tulsa, but I would hope Arkansas's defense is better than Tulsa's defense. And so I'd like to see a big, big leap from the defense.
Yeah, run defense. Arkansas, like I said, last in the league in that area through 3 weeks. And San Jose State last year was dead last in the country running the ball. I think they had the fewest rushing yards of any team, and they averaged like two yards a carry. I mean, they're looking a little bit better this year, like I think maybe 4.2 yards a carry, but Arkansas should be able to limit them if everything goes right. But, you know, with Bumper out, possibly with Bumper Pool possibly being out, maybe Hayden Henry out, you want to see how those backup linebackers come in and fill those spots potentially. And just want to see Nick Starkle just be a little bit sharper, hit those throws that he missed last week.
Yeah, contain the edge. Blow up some holes in the run game. I mean, run for a good chunk of yardage in this game. And then I'd like to see one over the top. I mean, if they came that close against Colorado State, they should darn sure come that close or better against San Jose. You know they're going to run them. And just the threat of it, if they get that on tape for these SEC teams to watch, then the safeties have to be more committed to helping out or being over the top of these receivers. And so I think an over-the-top touchdown is called for in this game.
All right, guys, close here to wrapping it up on the Whole Hog Football Podcast. Scotty Bordelon, Tom Murphy, and Bob Holt joining us. All right, this is hard to believe, but three games in, you know, about a 12-game season, we're 1/4 of the way through college football season. So through three games, what have you seen that's been, we're going to do both impressive and disappointing, but we'll start with the disappointing stuff and get that out of the way. What's been the most disappointing thing that you've seen from the Razorbacks this year? We'll start with you, Tom.
I would say the run defense. I thought it'd be a little bit stronger. I know that the injuries to the ends has played into that. And Scooter Harris just wasn't himself the first two games. He said he was not feeling his best, so we can maybe chalk some of it up to that. I wish they had settled on the quarterback situation a little sooner, because in the Ole Miss game, if Nick Starkle plays the whole game, maybe it's a completely different situation. I mean, maybe the drives go longer. We don't know. And so – also getting better, run blocking and just being able to run when you want to run. If it's third and two, you know you can run the ball and have a good chance of getting it. And the timing in the pass game. We see that's coming along, but in the first game against Portland State, I mean, everyone thought it would be a nice blowout, and it wasn't. And so we got on, you know, with this weird edge about what this team could be, and now people are feeling better because they scored a bunch of points last week.
What do you think, Tom? Or Bob, sorry.
That's okay.
You want to go again?
Yeah, I think the run defense is the obvious answer there, you know, because you think, well, geez, if Portland State and Colorado State, especially getting outside, could do that to them, than what are these SEC teams going to do. And they really had trouble containing. If you remember the Portland State game, their quarterback, Davis Alexander, had some pretty good scrambles. And the backup quarterback, freshman, whose name escapes me, it starts, I think it's Nick something. But he's their leading rusher.
Oh, Nick Nash. You're talking about the current game. I thought you were still on Portland State.
No.
Nick Nash.
Yeah, Nick Nash. He's their leading rusher. He's rushed for over 100 yards, so we're not sure how much he's going to play, but he's a guy that, you know, is pretty good with his legs, apparently. So, you know, I'd like to see him run defense would be a whole lot better and contain the quarterback. And, you know, Matt Corral ran on him pretty good, too.
You know, Nick Nash is a threat in the option game, too, so we'll see how Arkansas's, you know, kind of handles that and see what their discipline is like. And that kind of goes into maybe my most disappointing thing is the discipline on defense sometimes is lacking. Like, we've seen Arkansas come up with a couple of defensive scores, but like on the two busted plays they've gone for touchdowns, I mean, those are plays that could easily have gone the other way if you're a little bit more disciplined, play the ball instead of the receiver. And then you see teams just get to the edge a little bit too often on Arkansas, and quarterbacks can kind of scramble away from pressure, which can lead to, you know, 10, 15, 20 yard gains. Most impressive to me might be, you know, Trey Knox and Treylon Burks, man, they've been really good the first 3 weeks. I think Trey Knox is like one of three freshmen in the country that's got 200 plus receiving yards so far. He's been an animal, had a really, really nice game. Him and Treylon Burks combined for 10 and 182 and a touchdown last week. That's pretty special.
Yeah, those two guys. Starkle's play has been pretty good for a guy who hasn't been in the system long enough. Hope to see that continue. I think special teams, I don't think it's a huge leap from last year, but it's better than last year. The punting has been the average is not there because I think they had a lot of the try to pin them down punts that didn't work out for them, and they kept losing 20 yards on their net on those. But I think Sam Loy eventually will end up being a solid punter this year. Connor Limpert, obviously, SEC Player of the Week this week, has kicked well, and his kickoffs are better. And I think if Devion Warren and Treylon Burks get a seam, we're going to see one go for big distance in the near future.
And Bob, what do you got positive-wise? What's been the most improvement that you've seen from all?
Yeah, probably those freshman receivers, Burks and Knox. I think we knew they were going to be pretty good. And then, you know, Deion Stewart's season and an injury and Jordan Jones being hurt, that sort of – I don't think they were going to play a lot anyway, but maybe they were going to defer a little bit to those older guys, but they didn't really have a choice. And those freshmen have really proven, you know, up to the challenge, I guess, as the coaches say. The moment's not too big for them. And, you know, Starkle's clearly got confidence throwing those balls up kind of for grabs because he feels good those guys are going to get it. And they've shown the athleticism, I think, you know, the coaches were talking about when they recruited him. So, yeah, those two guys have been really impressive, the early starts to their college career.
Well, the moment wasn't too big for any of y'all either. Thanks so much for joining us here on the Whole Hog Football Podcast. Bob Holt, Tom Murphy, Scotty Bordelon, make sure to check out their stuff on wholehogsports.com and the Northwest Arkansas Democrat Gazette.
The Whole Hog Sports Football Podcast is produced and edited for Airship by me, Seth Cameron. Special shout-outs to Justin Allegri, Tom Murphy, Bob Holt, and Scotty Bordelon. You can hear more from Justin Allegri on the call of the Arkansas vs. San Jose State game on the San Jose State Radio Network. You can also read more from Scotty, Tom, and Bob on wholehogsports.com. Thank you to our sponsor, Massage Envy. By supporting them, you are supporting us. Don't forget to like and subscribe to the podcast. Subscribing and sharing is one of the best ways to let your friends know about this podcast. Sharing and liking is one of the best ways for us to grow as well. Theme music is by Silent Partner. I'm Seth Campbell for Whole Hog Sports. Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you back here next week.